Good morning. It's good to see you guys this morning. Let's stand. Let's worship this morning. Let's worship the God that we love.
We're glad you're here this morning, and let me remind you that we have, I think, 43 young people and adults at camp this week. They left yesterday. They got there safely last night. They were having credit card problems. The credit card company thought they were using fraud because they were filling up four vehicles at every gas station, and so I had to deal with that last night, so that's why I know they got there safe. And so let's be praying for them this morning as they're away for a week of camp. They're in a beautiful setting right on the beach at Pensacola, at a beautiful camp. But I'm telling you, God's going to move in those young people's lives and those adults' lives this week in a mighty way. So you look around, there's 43 people missing, gone on mission, or not mission trip, mission trips in July, but gone on youth camp. And so it's going to be a great week for them, and be praying that God really moves in their hearts this week. Also, if you'll notice on the front of your bulletin, there is information about the Praise-a-thon that's going to take place next Saturday for TCA. TCA is going very, very well towards reaching our goals and be able to stay open. We have a special called business meeting tonight at 5:30. Mark that down, 5:30 tonight, to vote to give them some money out of our general funds. And so come and be a part of that if God leads you to do that. And then, of course, we'll go back to Sunday night tonight at 6. We're glad you're here. We want to worship. We welcome you if you're watching on Facebook, and we're glad that you're with us today. And let's have a word of prayer. Father, thank you for today. Thank you for the opportunity to come together and worship you. Thank you for the safe trip for all those that went to camp this week. And thank you for David as he leads them. And Father, we just pray that they would have an amazing week, Lord, that your spirit would speak deep into their hearts this week. And all the outside influences would be put aside, Lord. And as they enjoy the beauty of what you've created with the wonderful Gulf of Mexico and the beach there, Lord, as they see that beauty, I pray they'd be moved to understand how big you are, how awesome you are, and how great you are. And Father, I pray that in those sessions and in those studies and in those services, Lord, that you just move on their hearts in a mighty, mighty way, and great things would happen in their lives, things that would change their lives forever as they restore their relationship with you during this week. Father, be with the adults that are there as well, and I pray the same thing would happen in their lives. And I pray you'd be with the group, Lord. Keep them safe. Keep them safe on the beach. Keep them safe in the ocean. Keep them safe when they're driving. Keep them safe in every way, and just cover them with the precious blood of Jesus and bless them. Father, we thank you for each one that's here today, and we pray that we would worship you as we already have. And Father, you'd move in our hearts, and this service would be a time of moving in our hearts and lives as we draw close to you. Father, come and bless us this morning. Be here in power and might, and may we turn our hearts towards you. And we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen.
Catch me when I'm falling.
but because of what you've done, not because of what I've done, but because of who you are. I am a flower quickly fading, here today and gone tomorrow, wave tossed in the ocean, vapor in the wind. Still you hear me when I'm calling, or you catch me when I'm falling. You told me who I am. I am yours. I am yours.
Amen. Time for prayer time. Are there those today that would like to be prayed for? If you'll come on, we'll gather around you. If y'all want to be prayed for today, come on up here to the front and we'll gather around you and pray for you. Okay. There is a white Toyota that needs prayed for. It's one of the handicapped spots and it's running. So unless you got a lot of gas money, you might want to go turn that off. Y'all come on up and gather in. Y'all come on and pray. Let's pray for these. Okay. Yeah. I don't need to do that publicly or not. Okay. Okay, let's go to the Lord in prayer. Christy, come on up here in the middle. We'll start with this, Christy. Christy says she's having some numbness in her hands and her feet, not going away. So let's just pray for her first, all right? Father, I just thank you for Christy, and I pray you reach out and touch her today. And Father, I pray that you give them wisdom as to what might be done, what needs to be done. Father, I pray that most of all, your healing hands would be upon her and there'd not be any issues there other than maybe a skeletal issue or a muscle issue that can be fixed with therapy or whatever it might be. Father, mostly I just pray you'd reach out and touch her in a mighty way and bless her, and I ask it in Jesus' name. And then I pray for Christy Hawkins, Lord, and I thank you, Lord, that she's doing well. I thank you, Lord, that we're seeing great results in her life. And Father, I just pray you'd bless her and watch over her. Father, I know the cancer's still there, but it's not harming her as much at this point. And Father, it's things are going well, and we thank you for that. But Lord, we pray it'd be completely gone in Jesus' name. Total remission, total healing in Jesus' precious, precious name. And we ask it by the shed blood of Jesus. Father, we continue and pray for Cindy, and thank you, Lord, for what you're doing in her life and how she's feeling right now. And Father, again, we know the cancer's not gone, but Lord, we pray it will be in Jesus' name, that she'll be in total remission. And Father, that you'd bring total healing to her body in Jesus' precious, precious name and by the power of his shed blood. Father, we pray for Megan Carpenter, who is having surgery this week, gallbladder surgery. We pray, Lord, that you bless her and that would go well, and you guide the doctors and be with her in a mighty way. And Father, we pray that you'd be with Randy's mom, Barbara. Barbara, right? And we pray, Lord, that you'd be with her. She's having tests and having difficulties and been in the hospital since Thursday. Father, we just pray that you'd reach down and touch her in a mighty way. We pray that your presence would be rich in her life. I pray you'd bind up the hearts of her family. And Father, that they'd feel your presence and your love through this situation. Father, we ask again for healing and a miracle. And we ask it in Jesus' precious, precious name. Father, as we continue our prayer, we pray for those that are on our list on a daily basis. And Father, we just pray you'd bless them, Lord, and watch over them. I don't have that list in front of me right now, but Lord, you know who each one of them is. And so, Father, I pray that you continue to be with those that we pray for week after week. And Father, I pray for Ginger as well. She asked for prayer this morning, and I pray you'd reach out and touch her in a mighty way, Father. I pray your spirit would be rich in her life. And Father, I pray that you'd be with all of those that are praying this day. And we pray, Lord, for our church. We pray, Lord, that you'd move in a mighty way in our church. We pray, Lord, that that we'd see the Spirit of God bring revival. We pray for Revival Walk as it officially kicks off this week. And Father, we'd see great things happen from that. And Lord, I already have a story to tell tonight. And so, Father, excited about what you're doing with the Revival Walk already. And Father, we do pray for our young people. We pray for their safety at camp, at Panama City Beach. And Father, we pray that not only would you watch over them in their safety, but as we prayed earlier, Lord, we pray you'd reach out and touch them spiritually in a mighty way. Father, may this be a life-changing week. Father, bless them. And thank you, Lord, for each one that's here today and move in this place. And we ask in Jesus' name.
Thank you.
be seated.
Thank you for the introduction, Danny. Appreciate you. Let me say just a word about tonight again. Our Sunday nights begin again tonight. Our Wednesday nights began last week. Wednesday night is prayer time in the auditorium. We had a really good prayer meeting Wednesday night. And so I'd invite you to come join us at 6 o'clock on Wednesday nights for prayer. And I believe it starts this week that, I think it's this week that the children will have something going on as well, and they'll be learning about prayer while we're meeting in the auditorium doing it. And so I think that'll be a good thing as well. So that's Wednesday nights. Tonight begins our Sunday nights. Let me just, before I get into the message, let me kind of share with you a little bit about what we're expecting out of Sunday nights. Sunday nights, this is going to be the summer of prayer, folks. You know, either David Jeremiah or one of them said this morning that if you want to destroy your crowd, spend 1 week on witnessing and the next one on prayer. But the bottom line is we are a prayerful church, and we know that it makes a huge difference. And so this is going to be a summer of prayer, and Sunday nights is going to be very informal. On Sunday nights, we're going to come together, and we're going to worship a couple of worship songs, and we're going to have times of testimony, and we're going to pray for folks. We're going to pray for folks whose names are brought forward from the prayer walking, whose names are brought forward for other reasons. And I don't know how this is going to go, but I'm expecting God's going to do some great things on Sunday nights. I think as we give the Holy Spirit the freedom to move on Sunday nights and freely move within our testimonies and our prayer without a planned agenda, I believe that God's going to use that. And I'm really believing that our Sunday nights could become the most spiritual time in the church this summer. It could be a very exciting time as God moves in a mighty way among us. And so I hope you'll come and be a part of that. You might say, well, I haven't signed up to prayer walk, and I'm not part of prayer walk, and that's okay. You can still come and pray and be a part of what's going on. And so it's for everybody. And there will be some prayer walk focus as far as some instructions and those kind of things. If you haven't signed up yet, there are signs out there you can purchase. You can sign up online, or you can circle the R on your bulletin for the end of the service, and we'll get you registered. If you are signed up and you haven't walked yet this week, that means you're due to walk today, because you need to walk before you come to prayer meeting tonight. Now, Cindy and I have been trying to walk all week. It kept raining and raining and raining, and so we haven't. So we'll be out walking today. Well, we walked a little bit one night, but not the whole neighborhood. And so we'll be out walking this afternoon, getting ready for the service tonight and praying for our neighbors. What a great thing. What could be wrong with praying for your neighbors? And several of my neighbors have already figured out that I'm praying for them. And I've not had any negative comments at all, none at all. And so I think people appreciate the fact that you care enough to get out and pray for your neighbors. We're in our third sermon on this new series, He Restores My Soul, Restoration. And I would ask you this morning as we look at this message, what's the greatest commandment? And I don't have to answer that question because the Bible does, right? A Pharisee asked Jesus that in Matthew 22, 36. In verse 37, Jesus said, love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your mind. That's the greatest commandment. And of course, we know the second one is what? Love your neighbor as yourself, which goes right into our prayer walk, right? Our revival walk. Same thing, revival walk. Love your neighbor as yourself. But unfortunately, the greatest commandments, love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your mind. But unfortunately, we have loved other things more. You know what the definition of loving other things more than loving the Lord our God with all our heart is? Sin. That's exactly what it is. That's sin. That's where all sin comes from, because we love other things more. There's only one solution for sin. It's not being good. It's not picking the religion of your choice and getting involved. It's not coming to church. There's only one solution for sin. You can't restore or rededicate what you haven't already dedicated. And the solution for sin is in the cross. The solution for sin is in Jesus Christ dying on the cross. For the last 2 weeks as we've started this new series, week one, we talked about how salvation restores your eternal life as you accept what Jesus did for you on the cross. Last week, we talked about how salvation restores your fellowship with God that was broken when you were born in sin. And because of what Jesus did on the cross. Have you come to that place in your life where you've asked Jesus to be your Lord and Savior? That's the only solution for sin. And today we're going to be talking about restoring Jesus as first in your life. But you can't restore Jesus as first in your life until you get him in your life. You can't rededicate what has never been dedicated. So I ask you again, have you come to a place in life where you ask Jesus to be your Lord and Savior, to live through you? Have you made Jesus the Lord of your life? If you have not, you do not have eternal life. You do not have fellowship with God. And this sermon won't do you any good until you do that first. You have to ask Jesus to be Lord of your life first. We find that in John 3. In John chapter 3, verse 1, there was a man from the Pharisees named Nicodemus, a ruler of the Jews. Verse 2 says, this man came to Jesus at night and said, Rabbi, we know that you come from God as a teacher, for no one could perform these signs you do unless God were with him. So here's this Pharisee, Nicodemus, a ruler of the Jews. He goes to see Jesus at night. Why did he go at night? He didn't want to be seen. He is doing it on the down low. He didn't want to be seen. He didn't want the other Pharisees to know that he was talking to this person that many of them considered the enemy of their faith. And so he went to Jesus quietly. He went to Jesus at night. And when he got the audience with Jesus, he compliments Jesus on his miracle signs. And he tells Jesus, even though he's a Pharisee, he tells Jesus that I believe you're from God. Nicodemus is so close to the truth at this point. Jesus was not just from God. Jesus was God in flesh. He's so close to the truth. But the bottom line is, even though Nicodemus believed that Jesus was sent by God, the Bible tells us that even the demons believe that Jesus is the Son of God. It's not enough. It wasn't enough for Nicodemus. Later, he came on into the truth, but it wasn't enough for him either. Most people believe that Jesus was the Son of God. I mean, fools don't. If you don't believe Jesus Christ is the Son of God, you're a fool. That's what the Bible says. I didn't say it. The Bible says you're a fool. And you are a fool. Because how could you believe that Jesus Christ didn't come and live 2,000 years ago? How can you believe that there was no Jesus on earth? How can you believe that all the people that witnessed what he did were lying? How can you believe that disciples and apostles who died for their faith died for a lie? How can you believe any of those things? Well, you say, well, it's 2,000 years ago. I don't think he was even here. Great. What did you write on your check the last time you wrote one? 2021. 2020 years after, 21 years after what? The birth of Jesus Christ. Our very Western system of time testifies to the fact that Jesus Christ was born and did live and was so famous that we still date time from his birthday. Wow. You see, if they did that about me, this would be, the year 64. They dated time from Jesus' birthday. Can you believe that? And yet, people say, oh, he didn't live. He wasn't the Son of God. The Bible's full of lies. The best-selling book in the world, that's still the best-selling book every year, that is owned by more people than any other book in the world, is not a lie. It's the truth, and that's why it's the bestseller. every year. Nicodemus was so close to the truth, but he wasn't ready to do anything about it. Jesus recognizes that, and he tells Nicodemus he needs to let it all go and trust him completely, trust Jesus completely. In verse 3, Jesus says, I assure you, unless someone is born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God. Nicodemus questions Jesus further, and Jesus tells him what born again means. And look at John 3:16, if you're following along in John, the verse we all know, for God loved the world in this way. He gave his one and only son so that everyone who believes in him will not perish but have eternal life. Now, wait a minute, preacher. You just said that believing that Jesus Christ is the Son of God is not enough. And this verse says everyone that believes in him will not perish but have eternal life. But you have to understand the difference in the words in the Greek. And the Greek word here is pistuo. The Greek word here simply translated believe, simply believe means not an intellectual belief, but a complete trust and reliance upon. It's not enough to believe with your head. It's got to move to your heart, and it's got to be strong enough that you're willing to say to Jesus Christ, be the Lord of my life. I trust you. I trust you. John used that same word 99 times in his writings. 99 times he used the word that means trust and depend upon. Not just know, but trust and depend upon. Paul put it this way in Romans. If you confess with your mouth Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. What do you got to do? You got to believe from your heart. And you've got to trust him to be the Lord, the master of your life. Have you dedicated your life to Christ? I'm asking again. Has there come a point in your life where you said yes to Jesus? You said, Jesus, I believe you are the Son of God, and I believe it so much I'm willing to rest my life on you. I'm willing to trust you with the rest of my life. I'm willing to believe it so much that I'm willing to live for you totally. That's what it means to be born again. It's the only solution for sin. Born again became very popular in our culture 20 or 30 years ago. It was a phrase tossed around by presidents and all kinds of people that they were born again. Started, really got made popular with Jimmy Carter. But born again has been cheapened by, it's way more than just I believe in Jesus. It's I believe in him so much that I trust him with my life. And why are you born again? Because the Spirit of God, when you trust him, comes to live in your heart and changes who you are. You're reborn. That's why it's called born again. Have you done that? Now let's go to our main passage, Revelation chapter 2. Revelation chapter 2. We're going to pick it up in the second verse. The first verse is kind of some greetings and things. The second verse says, Jesus says, I know your works, your labor, and your endurance. You know, you have to be born again first. We all should be working very hard for the cause of Christ because we gave our heart to him. And so therefore, people should be able to say of us, the Lord should be able to say of us, he belongs to me and he's working hard. He's working hard for the kingdom. You don't work hard to get to heaven. You work hard because you have inherited heaven. After we are born again, we ought to have a great desire to serve the Lord. But church work doesn't take the place of being born again. In Revelation, in the verse we're in, chapter 2, verse 2, the Lord is not saying that if you work hard enough, you can be born again. That's not what he's saying at all. He's saying to this church that this letter is written to, he's saying the problem here is that you've not been born again. And if you have been born again, you ought to have a desire to serve me. You ought to have a desire to work hard. I meet people that tell me they're born again. I meet people that tell me that they're saved, and yet they don't come to the church. They don't worship God in church. They don't serve God in any way, and yet they tell me they're born again. When you are born again, God places a desire in you to serve him because, after all, he saved you. He saved you from sin. He saved you from hell, and he saved you from certain death. and he gave you eternal life, why wouldn't you want to serve him? You know, this young lady down here, way back when, said, I do. I was so thrilled that somebody like her would say, I do to me, that I've never forgotten that. And I am eternally grateful that she committed her life to me. And that's the basis of my love for her. Jesus drew you out. He died for you. He said, I want you. And you responded to that, and you got saved. Why wouldn't you have a desire to serve him? Why wouldn't you have a desire to serve him? Do I forget once in a while how much I appreciate that she said, I do to me? Yeah, I do. I mean, I forget. I do too, but I forget. I forget sometimes. And then we have one of those moments where I'm wrong. You ever have those, guys? And most of the time, we already know we're wrong. We just don't admit it, right? And when we finally do, everything's better. Sure, we have those moments when we forget what Jesus has done for us and we find ourselves off in sin, or we get away for a while, or we're not doing what we ought to be doing for a while. But the bottom line, he loves you, he died for you, and if you really love him, you're going to come back. You're going to get it right because you have a desire to serve him. It also says in Revelation chapter 2, verse 2, that you cannot tolerate evil. You can't tolerate evil. Evil should not be tolerated in the church and should not be tolerated in the world. And after we're born again, we should work hard to stamp out evil. You know, it just goes over me when somebody says to me, politics don't belong in the church. We're supposed to stamp out evil. We already find more evil than in politics. Well, maybe Hollywood, but we're supposed to be working against evil. When somebody says to me, preacher, I just don't believe politics belongs in the church, then I want to say, well, maybe you should tell Jesus that, because the Pharisees were the rulers of the day, and he had plenty to say to the Pharisees. I mean, that's a false idea that politics don't belong in the church. The bottom line is the church should all be all about what's good and stamping out what's evil, and that means you have to get involved in politics. That means you have to get involved in moral issues. That means you have to get involved in what's going on our day. Because if what's going on our day, and it doesn't, by the way, if what's going on in our day doesn't line up with what the Word of God says, then it's evil. And there's a lot of evil going on in this world right now. And there's a lot of evil going on in this country right now. And there's a lot of evil going on in Washington, D.C. right now. And by the way, it starts with the White House. Joe Biden is doing everything he can to make it harder and harder for you to worship in freedom. And these liberal governors and liberal leaders that use COVID-19 as a chance to step on our amendment rights and say the church is not necessary anymore and close down churches are evil. Anybody that stands against the church of God and the word of God is evil, period. Well, I ought to get canceled for that one. Maybe Facebook will take me off now. Bottom line is, it's true. So we are to work against evil. But let me tell you, no matter how good you try to be and how much you work against evil, it's not enough. You ought to do that because you're born again, but you have to be born again. You can be a crusader against evil, but if you're not born again, you're still lost. You are still lost. So he says, I know your works, I know your labor, I know your endurance, I know that you cannot tolerate evil. That's all good things, and that's what he was saying to the church here in Ephesus. I know all these good things about you, but you still must be born again. Being born again is the start of being a Christian. I'm assuming most of you here have been born again. If you haven't, and you don't come down to the altar at the invitation time and get it straight, something's wrong with you. Because if you believe that Jesus really is the Son of God, he died for your sins, and he's the only way to heaven, and you haven't fixed it yet, wow. I stood in the hospital room of a man who had just died this week. We never know. We never know. You need to get it right. If you have gotten it right, then where are you at right now? How are you doing with it now? Sometimes after we're born again, got to be born again first, or none of this, rest of this doesn't matter. After you get born again, sometimes we get caught up in the things of the world and we begin to slowly fall away. And that's what the rest of this message is about. Restoring. Restoring that relationship with Jesus Christ. Coming to that place of restoration. Coming to that place of rededication. Lord, I thank you for what you did on the cross. And I thank you, Lord, because of what you did on the cross, we can be born again. And I know the majority of the folks that are here this morning are born again. Many that are watching online are born again. And we thank you for that opportunity. We thank you that you died on that cross, lived a perfect life, and died for our sin, not for yours because you had none. And you died for our sin that we might be forgiven. You shed your blood that we might be forgiven. And you have impress that on our hearts, and you have led us to the cross, and you have called us into salvation, and we have responded, and Lord, we have become born again. We have become saved. We have become new creation in Jesus Christ. But Lord, sometimes after that, we tend to fall away. And Lord, all of us at times have fallen away to some extent. And so Lord, help us to talk today and understand what the Word of God says today about restoration. After we've been born again, how we can be totally and completely restored. Verse 4. The Lord says this to the church at Ephesus, but I have this against you. You've been born again. You're doing all the right things. You're a conservative church doing all the right things, but I have this against you. What does he have against them? You've abandoned the love you had at first. You've abandoned your first love. He doesn't say you've forsaken Christ. That's not what he says at all. He says you've forsaken that fervent love that you had for him at first. Remember the greatest commandment? Love the Lord your God with all your heart and all your soul and all your mind. You know what the result of loving the Lord your God with all your soul and all your heart and all your mind is? Holiness. Holiness. Trying to be like Jesus. He didn't say you've forsaken Christ. He said you've forsaken that first love. It reminds me of a married couple who at one time had that fervent love. And then things got in the way. The world got in the way. The kids got in the way. Things got in the way. And they know it's wrong to divorce, so they're still together. They haven't forsaken each other, but they've forsaken that love they had in the beginning. And that's what he's saying here. It's like, no, you haven't forsaken Christ. You're still coming to church. You're still, you know, serving him. You're still fighting evil. You're still doing all the stuff you ought to be doing. But you don't love him like you used to. You've forgotten what it was like to love him with all your heart and all your soul and all your mind. That love that we ought to have needs to be taken care of. If it's not taken care of, it will cool. If you haven't figured this out yet, love is work. Love's not just some feeling that you get when you're 13 years old and a cute girl smiles at you the first time. Love's not what you feel for your dog. Although some of you probably love your dogs more than your wives, and that's the problem. Might have stepped on a toe or two there, you think? Bottom line is, love is not just a feeling. There's a song about that, I think. Love is work. Love is a conscious decision to give yourself to someone else. And if you don't take care of that love, if you don't work at that love, it cools down. I've spent a lot of time counseling couples that the love has cooled down. And it's really not that hard to revive it. I did a counseling session a while back. I said, all right, here's where we're going to start. Here's where we're going to start. This week, I want you to do something unexpected for your wife, something she won't see coming, something you would usually wouldn't do, something good that you know that she will enjoy. And then to the wife, I want you to do something unexpected for your husband, something that he wouldn't see coming. You know, we got to stop this downward spiral, and we got to start spiraling back up. It works. It's just the beginning part, but it works. We have to work at taking care of the love. Spend time with the Lord God. Spend time with Jesus. Don't put others and other things ahead of Jesus. You know, back to the marriage illustration, because this is a great one with this one. When the husband's out with his friends every night of the week and the wife's sitting at home alone, how's the love going? How's the love going? And when everything else gets put in front of Jesus, when everything else gets put in front of your prayer time, when everything else gets put in front of your Bible study time, when everything else gets put in front of worship. You know, there used to be a day that Sunday was the Lord's day, and we didn't do all this other junk on Sunday. Now we do all kinds of things on Sunday besides worship. And when those things begin to get in the way of worship, when they begin to get in the way of time spent with the Lord, guess what? The love's going to cool down. The love's going to cool down. I don't know about you. I need worship. And I know I'm leading part of it, but I need to study to get ready to lead. That helps me a lot with keeping the love going. But I need to be here. I'm not just the leader of this church. I'm a part of the family of God here, and I need to be with my family of God. And when you're not here, I miss you. I'm not saying you miss one Sunday and you call me and say, was I there or not, or not today? But I'm telling you, eventually I'm going to figure it out. And I'm going to miss you because you're my family, and I need that family love to help me love Jesus more. And you know, Jesus is grieved when people grow cold towards him, people that are born again. We see it in Revelation chapter 3, verses 15 and 16. Jesus said this, I know your works, that you're neither hot nor cold. I wish that you were cold or hot. So because you are lukewarm and neither hot nor cold, I'm going to vomit you out of my mouth. When was the last time you got a cup of coffee and it was nice and hot and it was fixed just right, and then you kind of forgot about it for a while and you come back to it and you pick it up and take a sip and it's just lukewarm? I mean, you know, it's just not good. Makes you want to spit it out. And that's what Jesus is saying. I'd rather you be totally cold towards me or totally hot towards me, but in between, that's not good at all. He wants us to stay hot in our relationship with him, to love him with all of our hearts. How does this happen? How do you get to the point where you abandon that love that you had at first? Well, I'll give you three ways. There's others. First one, materialism. Backslide into the world. In this country where we have all the conveniences and all the pleasures of life, it's easy to fall away from what we really need and put all of our time and energy into what we need the least. I run across people all the time that started making more and more and more money, and it's never enough. Have you figured that out? It doesn't matter how much you got socked away and whether you're fit set for the rest of your life or not, you're still going to read the stock market every day. You know, you want to know where my money's at, what's it doing, and how it's doing. Nothing wrong with that until it starts to replace your relationship with Jesus Christ. And we lose our focus on Christianity, we lose our focus on Jesus, we lose our focus on what's important in life to the point that everything else is in front of Jesus, materialism takes over. It's so important that we give the Lord his first, that we serve the Lord first. You know, it's really easy to get involved in the rat race. More things, bigger houses, more boats, more payments, more work, more debt, no time for the Lord, and no money for the Lord because we're so deep in debt we spend more in interest than our tithe would be because we had to have the things. That's one of the ways it cools off. Let me give you another one that'll surprise you. One of the ways our love can cool off for the Lord is church work. Really? Church work? New Christian discovers that first love. He's excited to serve the Lord. People see how much he loves Jesus, and they give him more and more responsibility in the church. And at some point, sometimes a subtle change takes place. This person who started by loving Jesus with all of his heart and all of his mind and all of his soul and was gifted by God finds himself at the very center of the decision-making of the church. And if he's not careful, the drive to be somebody important at church takes over in that love for Jesus. Instead of being motivated by the love of Christ, you find your motivation comes from the organization. Some find their motivation comes from controversy. And yes, even in the church, some motivation doesn't come from love for Jesus. It comes from ambition for power. There are even in the church people that just want to be in charge. Ambition for power. And that first love that started out with you loving Jesus so much you wanted to serve him with all your heart, you started serving in the church, and before long you loved the church more than you loved Jesus. Ambition for power. You know, one of these days, I'm going to retire. I have no idea when. Not anytime soon, if you're hoping. I don't know when I'm going to retire. But you know what I'm looking forward to when the day comes that I finally say, okay, I'm done with full-time ministry. You know what I'm looking forward to? Preaching every Sunday without the responsibilities of the power that goes along with it. I love people. I love being with people. I love preaching God's word. But sometimes I could just do without all that administration. I'm not power hungry. I can tell you that. I just want to serve God. But it's easy for even preachers to come to that point where they're so power hungry, every decision has to go through them. And if they don't get their way, they're mad. And that's not love for Jesus. That's love of power. Church work, if we're not careful, can replace our first love, which should be Jesus. And we can become preoccupied with themes and goals and points, doctrinal issues that would have never won us to Christ to begin with. Why do we think they're so important now? The bottom line is we serve because we love. The same thing happens in marriages and friendships and all kinds of things. We forget about how much we love somebody, and we start to worry about all the little details. Yes, it can be sidetracked by church work. It can be sidetracked by materialism. And then the third one's the most obvious, sin. It can be sidetracked by sin. One of the things I hate about Satan is he's smart. After all, he was the head angel at one time. He's smart. And he attacks you at your weakest point. And he knows what it is. I mean, we were in a restaurant last night eating. There was a wine list there. It was standing up. I saw it was the wine list. I laid it over to the side. I'm not tempted by that. Satan doesn't even try. He knows I don't care about that. I don't care about spirits except for his spirit. So he knows that doesn't tempt me. But let me tell you, he knows how to push my buttons in some other areas. He knows where to spend his time and his effort to tempt us to fall into sin. And I don't know about you, but when I sin, I know I'm a child of God because I'm guilty, and I know I'm a child of God because I feel bad, and I know I'm a child of God because I want to run to the Father and say, please forgive me. Please forgive me. But if we allow it to happen, sin can be very subtle, and it can begin to change us a little at a time. And maybe we do this, or we do that, or we do this, and it's just one time or a couple of times, or it's not that big a deal, the attitude's not that big a deal, and one day we wake up and we have gone way down the road of sin, and we have forgotten our first love. Don't forget your first love. Love the Lord your God with all your heart, all your mind, all your soul, and all your strength. Now, something else may have caused it, but if that's you, If you realize right this moment that you are not loving Jesus like you did at first, that you don't love Jesus like you did the day you got saved. In fact, it ought to be stronger than that. If you don't love Jesus like you did at first and you realize that you have gone down this road of backsliding, you have gone down this road of needing restoration, how do you get it? And verse 5 tells us, and I'll be done. Three words in verse 5, remember, repent, and remove. Remember, repent, and remove. Verse 5, remember how far you have fallen. Remember how it was. Remember how it was in the beginning. If you're having issues with one of your children, remember how you felt the day you held them for the first time in the hospital. Now, I know they grow up to be stinkers, but remember that. And it ought to cause you to love them no matter what they're involved in, no matter how they're treating you. Remember that. You having trouble in your marriage? Remember how you felt the day you stood at the altar in front of that preacher and said, I do. I do. Remember where you came from. Remember what it was like at first. And if you're having trouble in your relationship with Jesus Christ and you realize that I've been talking about you this morning as I've read this scripture because you have fallen away and you don't love the Lord like you used to and you're not living for him or serving him like you used to and you're not in church like you ought to be, remember how it was in the beginning with the Lord when you were first saved. Remember the excitement. Remember the joy. Remember the peace that came over you when you realized your sins were forgiven and you're on your way to heaven. And by the way, that relationship with the Lord shouldn't be the same as it was then. It ought to be better. It ought to be deeper. It ought to be a lot more understanding on your part. It ought to be more real. Remember. Secondly, repent. He says, remember how far you have fallen. Repent and do the works you did at first. I mentioned this a while ago. You want to renew your relationship with your wife? Act like you're dating her again. Act like you're dating her again. You may think that's funny. I think it's serious. Act like you're dating her again. What did you do to win her? When you were dating, what did you do to win her love? Why did you stop? When you were dating your husband, what did you do to win his love? Why did you stop? Repent. Go back and do the things that you did at first. You want to renew your relationship with Jesus Christ? Do the things you did at first. Open your heart to him. Pray. Listen to God's word. Repent of the sin in your life and live for him in daily worship and communion. Live for him. And above all else, put Jesus first. Put Jesus first. If he's anywhere on your list of priorities except at the top, then you need to put him first. He needs to be first in your life. He wants to be first in your life. And by the way, he even goes above you. I mean, in this lost world, most people's priorities start with me. And then the people that I love that love me back. For a Christian, the priority list starts with Jesus. And what's the second command? Love yourself? No. Second command is love your neighbors as yourself. You're way down the list, folks, if you're putting Jesus first. It's not about what I want anymore. It's about what he wants. Put him first. Put his needs above your own. And what happens if you don't remember and you don't repent? Otherwise, it says, I will come to you and remove your lampstand from its place. Unless you repent. What he's saying here to the church in Ephesians and the church at Ephesus, hard work's not enough, church. If hard work is what a church depends on, they'll die eventually. Their lamp will be removed. Hard work should be undergirded by love. We work hard for the kingdom because we love God. We come and we pray on Wednesday nights and Sunday nights because we love the Lord. We come and we pray in our morning devotionals because we love the Lord. It's not so we can get what we want on the wish list. It's because we love Jesus and we want to commune with him. To the individual, you must repent. If you're lost and you haven't been born again like we talked about earlier and you've never given your heart to the Lord, you can't repent. Repent means to go back to what you used to do when the Lord was first in your life. You can't repent. He never was first. You can't be restored if you've never been saved. You can't rededicate what's never been dedicated. But if you're born again, to the individual that's born again, then we need to repent. And I don't know about you, but I repent pretty often, pretty much daily. We need to repent. If we don't repent, we won't be used by God. I don't know about you, but I want to be used by God. And if you want to be used by God, you just need to be restored. You need to repent. You need to get the sin out of your life, and you need to let the Lord have first place in your life once again. Restoration. The greatest privilege in life is to be used by God. I believe that with all of my heart. And as I look at what God's got ahead for us as a church, there's a lot of churches he could use. There's a lot of churches that will get out there and work hard for the Lord and love him. I want to be one of those. I want to be used by God. I want Minor Baptist Church to be a church that changes the community. I want Minor Baptist Church to be a people who changes their neighborhoods. I want Minor Baptist Church to be used by God, and I personally want to be used by God. One of these days, I'm going to stand before him. And I sure don't want to hear him say, you loved other things more than you loved me. I don't want to hear him say that you were good, you were conservative, you worked hard, but you didn't love me like you should have. I want him to say, well done, thou good and faithful servant, because you loved me with all your heart and you served me with all your might. That's who I want to be. I hope that's who you want to be. You say, you're the preacher, you're supposed to want that. No, I'm not. I'm just a Christian like you. That's what we all ought to want. Do you love the Lord your God with all your heart? Or have you lost your first love? Let's stand for prayer. Father, speak to our hearts right now. You love us like nobody else ever has. You love us so much that you gave your life for us. And Lord, there's somebody watching at home or somebody here today that's never given their life to you. I pray today would be the day that they give themselves to you. Find out what it means to be born again and get started in the right direction for the rest of their life. Lord, if there are those here today that know they're born again, but somehow or another they've lost that first love, oh, they still know they're all saved, they still know they're on their way to heaven, but it just doesn't seem like that big a deal anymore. Oh, God, touch that heart. Touch that heart. Draw them close to you. Let them understand that we ought to be in a lifelong love affair with Jesus Christ. We ought to love him so much that we look forward to serving him. We look forward to our prayer times. We look forward to reading his word and letting him speak to us. And we are his willing servants. Lord, just take control of this time, and we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. You come as God leads you.
Change my heart, oh God, make it ever true. Change my heart, oh God, may I be like you. Change my heart, oh. Thank you.
have somebody present, and then he'll do the announcements.
Dorothy, if you'll come. This is Dorothy Smith, and she's been coming for quite some time, and she comes this morning wanting to be a part of our church. So just give her a great big hand. Amen. And Dorothy, when we dismiss, if you'll stand back there and let people come by and shake your hand, okay? We want to... We want to encourage you to remember to read your bulletin and look at all the things that are going on. One of the things I want to emphasize is we have the privilege over the next couple of weeks to host the Army or the military, and they're going to be doing a military training here utilizing our facilities. Because of that, and because that they're going to be sleeping in several of the rooms, I've placed some yellow papers like this in some of your rooms, and some of you will be moving to different places. If you have questions about that, please see me afterwards or call me throughout the week, and we'll discuss those things. Yes, starting next week, just for 2 weeks. We want to remind you of our Wednesday evening prayer meeting and Bible study. That's for the whole church. We would encourage you to come out, as Brother Mitch said, in our Sunday night prayer meeting tonight. We have business meeting at 5:30 this evening. We also have a new members class today in room 420, and we would encourage you to be a part of that. I think it's time for, I forgot something. The slide says that next Sunday at the recreation complex from 12 to 2, they're going to be having a picnic in the park for families and kids, and we'd encourage you to put that on your calendar also. Did I say anything about deacons meeting? Well, we have deacons meeting today following life groups in room 419. If the ushers will come and receive the offering, we have a video.
What is prayer? Stale tradition. Ritual. A good luck charm. Part of some religious checklist. Done to appease a higher being so we can get what we want. Or at least avoid the lightning bolt. Prayer has been redefined and twisted and confused. But at its essence, prayer is simply talking to God. The God who spoke the universe into creation, who gives us life and breath, who holds all things together. This God wants us to talk to him. In the vastness of all that exists, he actually cares about us, personally, individually. How can we not pray to such a loving God, wherever we are? How can we not thank him for what he's done? Or cry out when we need help, when we need forgiveness, when we're afraid, when we give thanks for our blessing or question where our next meal will come from? Why would we live a life apart from him? It's not about formula. How could any posture or well-chosen word impress the author of time and space? It's simple obedience. God has made himself available to us. He wants to hear from us. He wants us to trust in him, to acknowledge our dependence on him, to draw near to the one who loved us first. Approaching with confidence because Christ has torn away the veil. He's washed away the sin that kept us from his presence. And we live in relationship with our Lord. And so we ask that his kingdom come, his will be done on earth and in our lives as it is in heaven. That is prayer.
have a couple of Bibles to give out and baptism certificates. Eli Parker. God bless you, Eli. And Milo Kinder. God bless you, Milo. Gabe is our Deacon of the Week, and as we dismiss in prayer, had a message a minute ago about Cindy Keene is in the hospital and is going back for tests this morning. She's doing a lot worse, and so just remember Cindy in your prayers as she has these tests. Also, today is D-Day, which means a lot of things to a lot of people, but it means a whole lot to our country, so remember those that died on D-Day as well. Gabe, let's stand for prayer.
Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for this day you've allowed us to gather, God. We ask you to be with the prayer requests that were brought up, Cindy, and also thank you for those who sacrificed their lives on D-Day, God, that allow us to be here today. And God, we ask you to just be with us as we grow throughout this week. And remember that, you know, our passions don't need to take over our worship of you, God. Let us bring you into our passions, God, and thank you for the things that we have. Thank you for everything you do for us. Forgive us where we fail you. In your name, amen.